Joining us in the first portion of the show is the famous Reverend Ike, the founder and senior minister of the United Christian Evangelistic Association. Reverend Ike has two new series of cassettes out. One is called Thank God for Money, the other Your Power of Visualization. And one must say this about Reverend Ike. You may be the most honest of all of the television preachers, since all of them are, in a sense, out for money. You're the only one saying it. Do you ever get that feeling?
Well, sometimes I think I am less apologetic in my attitude toward money. You know, the Apostle Paul said that the love of money is the root of all evil until I came along to correct him.
He was wrong.
It is the love, it is the lack of money more than the love of money that is the root of all evil. I think people do more evil things because of the lack of money than because of the plentitude of money.
But how do you react when people say that Ike bases his whole ministry on the dollar and making him rich?
Well, they are correct in a sense.
I gotta say that for you. Make you rich and that'll make them happy.
First of all, I got into this business of praying for people to get money and teaching people to get money because in my ministry, I found out that that was people's greatest problem. And I believe and I know that Jesus met people at the point of their need. Whatever their need was, Jesus met that need. When people were hungry, he provided bread. And there is a case in the Gospels where the apostle came to Jesus and said, Lord, we don't have money to pay our taxes. This is tax day, by the way. And Jesus told Peter to go fishing, and he would find money in the fish's mouth. And so, frankly, the Bible is a book of prosperity. The Bible also says, and God says this in the Bible, Beloved, I wish above all things that you would prosper and be in health, even as your soul prospers.
But Jesus didn't get rich. The preacher didn't get rich. In other words, how would you react to what Lenny Bruce once said, which is that any person who says that he got a calling from God to preach the word, who has more than one suit, while somebody has no clothes, is a cop-out.
I disagree with that because there are a lot of people who don't want a suit. We all don't want the same thing. There are people who don't want Rolls Royces. But just because other people don't want a suit, that should not be imposed upon me.
Yeah, I know, but if you're leading me to a better world and giving you a Rolls Royce makes it a better world for you, and you asked me to help you get a Rolls Royce.
I've also taught many people to get their own Rolls Royces. One of my very good supporters has me to give away Rolls Royces for them every year at their beauty show because I help to motivate them to start their own beauty products business on their own kitchen stove. And several times a year, they take over the Rolls Royce dealership in New York and have me present the key to new Rolls Royces to people who have sold millions of dollars worth of their products.
To your credit, do you think that of the television ministries, you are the most honest?
I'm not touchy about money. I don't apologize for my success and my prosperity. And most preachers are apologetic about it because they care what people think. I don't apologize for my success and prosperity because I remember growing up in South Carolina when lunch was 7 cents a day and I didn't have 7 cents for lunch. And it was always one of my prayers to get to the point where I could fulfill the 23rd Psalm, where it says, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. And I teach this philosophy to a lot of people. I get a lot of people off of welfare because I teach people you can be what you want to be, you can do what you want to do, you can have what you want to have if you believe in the God in you. So just as Jesus said, I go to prepare the place for you so that where I am, there you may be also. So I teach people how to be just as prosperous as I am.
Were you the first black to break through the previous white control of what was television ministries?
I'm probably the first black person to become, let's say, an internationally known evangelist on this scale.
Now, Father Divine was famous, was he not?
Yes, but this was before the days of television.
Right, but on television, you certainly broke that barrier. Was that difficult?
No, it wasn't. You know, this was back in 1971. I had no better sense than to rent Madison Square Garden and to say, y'all come. And the people never got in. And that's where I started my television ministry.
They never got in. You mean you had to turn people away?
Yes, people had to turn people away. Over 20,000 people turned out. And so I put that meeting on television.
Does it ever bother you if you learn that a poor person contributed to you?
It happens all the time. And there's something miraculous about turning people's mentality from the idea I don't have to the idea of being a giver. As a matter of fact, that is one of the secrets of my success. You see, I too am a giver. I learned how to give. I tithe and I give offerings. And by the way, on radio and television, all of the money that comes in, for some reason, I get the idea that maybe the media is trying to tell people that I and the other television evangelists put all these millions of dollars in our pockets. We do not. It cost me and us millions of dollars every year for radio and television and to operate the church and the school in New York. We get people off of drugs. We have a drug deliverance program. We educate people. We have a business of living institute where we teach people how to get into their own businesses. We have people in their own businesses who never had any idea they'd be in business. One young man came to us. His life was so messed up. He was such a drunkard. He said, if this doesn't work, I'm going to kill myself. We got him into his own business, and he's a businessman today. And this happens many, many times. So we're using all of this money to provide people inspiration, motivation, and education. And in my case, to get people off of welfare, and we're turning them into self-supporting, contributing members of society.
So you have no guilt over being rich?
No guilt, because I teach success and prosperity. I feel called of God to teach and to preach success and prosperity without apology. And that is my calling. There was a joke going around some time ago that says, if you want to be saved, see Billy Graham. If you want to be healed, see Oral Roberts. If you want money, see Reverend Ike.
How about Oral Roberts and the God is going to kill me pitch?
Well, first of all, people have forgotten one very important element about Oral Roberts and that quote-unquote pitch. He did not ask for this money to line his pockets. People forget that quickly. He asked for this money to train medical missionaries, and people should remember that, for a work of mercy and compassion.
How do you feel about the Baker thing?
Well, I think it's a very unfortunate thing. However, I would like to quote Jesus, who said to those who brought a woman to him that was caught in the act of adultery, those of you who are without sin, cast the first stone. And I think that the attitude of ministers and Christians in particular should be an attitude of love and forgiveness and restoration. Because here is a man who has confessed that he has made a mistake. He says God forgave him, his wife forgave him, we should forgive him.
Well, how many followers do you have? Are there members of your church?
Our church has members. I don't like the word followers, because here again, we don't teach people to simply follow a man. We teach people to follow the God within. In my ministry, I say God is in me, the same God is in you, and I think that this is what Jesus came to show us. And we like to bring people into contact with this God within and have them follow that indwelling God, that indwelling wisdom.
You have no, say, guilt over Rolls Royces?
Absolutely not. How can I teach? How can I teach success and prosperity unless I am an example? And only people who are really... Well, I don't like to put it this way, but here it is where it's at. People who are envious object to success and prosperity, and you can't help them until they give up their envy anyway.
Let me read. You have ten. By the way, you believe in the Ten Commandments, right?
Absolutely.
But you have 10 commandments of money. I just want to say
yes.
These are correct. Thou shalt not think that money is evil. Thou shalt not speak evil of money. Thou shalt do right about money. Thou shalt give right about money. Thou shalt not serve money, rather shall serve you. Thou shalt not be aware that money loves you. Thou shalt not fear money, that it will corrupt you. Thou shalt not deny money. If you deny money, money will deny you. Thou shalt see to it that thy money makes money. Thou shalt not seek something for nothing.
Absolutely.
This is all very, very, very mercenary.
It is indeed, and in this world, it requires money. Money has its place. Remember, Jesus said, seek you first the kingdom of God. That's the spiritual aspect of life. And we teach this. I just finished an 8-day series on spiritual priority at our church and school in New York. But Jesus says, when you find the spiritual part within, the God within, then all of the things shall be added unto you.
On these tapes, you're showing people how they can make money?
Absolutely.
Must they be believers?
Well, they have to believe in themselves. You see, I don't teach people to believe in a God in the sky or to believe in just simply a God in me, but the God that is within. As I interpret Jesus, Jesus said, I and my Father are one. And to me, Jesus was saying, every man is one with God. And I've come to let you know that you are one with God.